work session for the Council of the City of Norfolk will now commence. Mr. Roberts, the floor is yours.
Thank you, sir. Good afternoon, Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of City Council. I'll provide a brief overview of the work session agenda. We do have a full agenda this afternoon. The first item is a brief presentation by Kelly Straub, Director of Communications, updating Council on Norfolk TV and our efforts to make access to Council Channel, Council meetings, other public meetings available by a number of media that's available to our citizens. So Kelly will provide that overview in just a minute. Then we will have a presentation on what we're referring to as a development showcase. Council will remember back at your spring retreat, we talked about efforts to market a number of vacant opportunities that the city owns, vacant properties for redevelopment. We have a showcase planned on October 16th where we'll do just that. Bobby Tahan, Director of Planning, is going to provide the overview. He'll be supported by Dr. Susan Perry, Director of Housing, Community Development, and Sean Washington, Director of Development. That'll be followed by the standing city planning update. Mr. Tahan, Director of Planning, will provide that presentation. The final presentation on the afternoon will be Norfolk Fire and Rescue overview of our proposed paramedic pilot program. Chief Sid Carroll, Norfolk Fire and Rescue, will provide that. And that's in advance of an item we anticipate putting on a future agenda for you to update your compensation plan in support of that program. So with that, if there's no amendments or objections, I'll call up our first presenter, Kelly Straub, Director of Communications.
Welcome.
Good afternoon, Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of Council. I'll just take a couple of minutes to update you on some exciting changes for our very own Norfolk TV. As you're all well aware, it's previously been available through Cox Channel 48 and online at norfolk.gov. But I'm excited to announce that we are now streaming. So you can actually download the Norfolk TV app to your phones or to your TV via Apple TV or Roku. So whether you have cable or not, you're now going to be able to see all of our programming from Norfolk TV, including our council sessions, including Planning Commission, and all of our other programming. One of the things that I wanted to make sure to share with you is that for those of us who love data, this gives us some better insight into our viewership. So we are able to see who is downloading, where they're downloading. So if it's through specific apps, you know, on Apple TV or Roku, we're able to get those numbers and kind of follow and see if we're making a difference there. But we can also see our viewership and see where those spikes are. That'll help us address what our programming needs are and what kind of interest our viewers have in our programming. So we'll make sure that that information is available to you as well. So again, just a quick plug for the Norfolk TV app. Download it to your phones, download it to your TVs when you get home tonight, and you're able to enjoy all of our programming, whether you have cable or not. That's all I have.
Yes, first, Ms. Worcester to Ms. Johnson.
Two quick questions. Is it a free app? So that's something that often comes up. Is it a free app, free subscription?
Yes.
Okay.
So as long as you have Roku or Apple TV, you can download the app, or you can download it to your phone, but the app itself is free.
Okay, got it. And it will still be available to view on Channel 48 and Norfolk.gov. Perfect. Thank you.
Okay, Ms. Johnson.
Yes, ma'am. Director Kelly Straub.
This is wonderful.
Yes.
Norfolk is open for business because this is fantastic.
Yes.
So thank you for us making that shift. And,
it works.
And with technology, thank
yes.
you so very
thank
much.
You. I'm a data point now.
Yes, I would say thank you for adding to our numbers already.
Yes, before I go to Ms. McClellan, tell me how are you going to use the data? Two data sets you mentioned. Repeat those data sets and tell us how you're going to use those data to inform future programming or activity. So speak to that.
Yeah, so previously, the cable options, we weren't able to monitor viewership in any way. This will actually allow us to see how many folks are actually downloading the app. So that's one set of numbers that we'll be able to monitor. So anytime we push out the information, we'll be able to go back in and see, you know, was that moving the needle to add to our viewership numbers? The second part is actually seeing what those viewership numbers look like. So We've actually already seen spikes during council sessions, so we know people are tuning in for these meetings. But then we can also take a look and see what additional programming are folks tuning in for. So we'll be able to then determine if we need to do more like that, a little less over here. It'll just kind of help put our resources into making sure that the programming that we're putting out is what viewers are looking for.
Yes, thanks, Kelly. So so using an example, recently in our in Super Ward 6, Ward 2, we had a special meeting. And we sent out, the communications department sent out a postcard to residents of that area in Larchmont. Can you geofence and target media via our social media channels and the TV app? I'm just thinking as another, believe it or not, not everybody checks their mailbox. I have two children who do not. They don't have their mailbox key even. But can we, are we doing that as well?
I will have to see what we're able to pull from the data on the back end for the app specifically and if it gets into that kind of demographic information.
I'm sorry, this is sort of adjacent to the app.
Okay.
So I'm just thinking as, you know, from campaigns, political campaigns, we can geofence and we can target specific audiences. Do we do that in the communications department where we're sending out notifications, et cetera, as we would typically in the mail or via civic leagues? Are we using social media channels to also... I know we do Nextdoor, which is great,
yes,
by the way. But are we doing that as well?
For specific campaigns as needed, we will target. That requires typically a little extra budgeting for specific campaigns, so it depends on the reach that we're trying to get. But we do have the ability to do it and have on occasion.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great job.
Next up, we have Dr. Susan Perry, or Bobby Tahan, rather. Bobby's got the presentation.
Mr. Manager, and Mayor, Vice Mayor, members of City Council. Planning, development, and housing and community development are putting together an event called that we're calling the Norfolk Development Showcase. Where we're taking an opportunity at the council's direction from the retreat, of course, to start marketing some of the properties in the city. We're trying to take a measured approach to try to make sure that we can, one, pull off an event like this and provide information that's useful for the public and for potential developers, but also to be able to start taking bites of the apple in order to try to move the needle and try to sell and market some of these properties. So again, the goal is to increase private sector interest in city-owned properties. There are a number of properties, as been noted by council members, that the city owns and that we're looking to potentially have put back onto the tax roll, as well as have new developments and redevelopments identified. We're also looking to try to identify development partners and in some cases new development partners where we're able to have folks with different capacities to provide them an opportunity either to build or to scale up your building in order to have an opportunity in this showcase. And then also we're piloting this project as a template for potential future projects. Again, this event is next week, October 16th from 11 a.m. to 6 p.m. And again, this is gonna be at the Kroc Center and we have invited a number of folks to attend this meeting. Again, this is a partnership between planning, economic development, and housing and community development. Each of us play a role in either providing information or potentially marketing each of these properties. What we tend to see and what we do on a daily basis, our staff members work with people that call in and ask about certain properties, and we provide them with information. Our goal at this showcase is to provide them the same information that we would provide if someone gave us a call doing some due diligence to help them kind of get that first step and to potentially come up with proposals. WPA is providing logistical support. We are trying to put this together and figure out how to do this, and so we didn't have something kind of in the box for this, so we did request some support from our urban design professionals. And we are featuring 12 properties that could potentially either provide missing middle, multifamily, and commercial opportunities in the city. And as well, we have 10 individual residential lots that we'll focus on that could potentially be focused in during the residential auction process that we currently have. Here's the agenda for next week. We do plan on having a welcome with opening remarks. an overview of the area and kind of some of the information. We are, because of the way the properties were grouped together in order to provide an efficient meeting, we did select an area in the central part of the city to try to give this a test run and give us an opportunity to really see if we can provide all of the site visits as well as information in an efficient manner. We are planning to have a pretty significant work session for each of these items. We're anticipating to spend about 10 minutes on each property and to allow for questions from the development and community to have them just kind of ask and they have us kind of locked in the room. So they have the opportunity to ask us questions and kind of what our vision is. We have flyers for each property, except for the individual residential ones, where we've kind of pulled out information from the comp plan, utilities, existing information and due diligence that the city has provided or done previously. And we're trying to package that up together so that they will have this information at their fingertips. From 2 to 4 p.m., we are planning on doing a property tour, which is why we kind of tried to group the properties together to have an efficient time to go and take a look at some of these potential properties for development. And then from 4 to 6 p.m., we're having a reception with the potential to have the community and the developers meet and try to have them come in and be a part of our community and understand the people that they will be interfacing with and interacting with if they choose to develop in the city and in that area. Again, like I noted, the property work session will go over each of those individual properties. We've pulled a number of data sets that we have as well as any of the due diligence and plans that we've already done previously. I'm noting again, key information, size, the appraise and assess value if we have it, the zoning as well as the comprehensive plan information, any approved area plans, utility availability, not necessarily capacity, but if it's there. What we've noted is community desires that we captured either in the comprehensive plan or public meeting process, and any renderings or concept drawings that we've come up with during this time as we've held these properties. Invitations have been sent to about 100 developers, contractors, and builders at this time. Coming to the events so far, I think we have just shy of 60 people that are signed up to come and attend. And so we have a good turnout based on who we reached out to. We're hopeful that we're able to, again, one, provide opportunities for people to understand where we own properties that are available to be developed, but also two, hopefully maybe scale up to a couple of the developers that are maybe doing one or two homes and maybe give them an opportunity to kind of go up to the next level to build multiple sets of homes so that they can continue to grow their business and help us in our redevelopment process. So again, the event is next week on October 16th. QR code is listed here. If anyone would like to try to sign up, we didn't limit the number. There is a limited capacity at the Proc Center for us to have. But we are hoping to fill the room.
Try that one out too.
And have.
I already did. Yeah, I just didn't turn it on really loud.
Yeah, we're looking to fill the room and have developers and other folks available to try to look at these properties and give us some feedback as well. So hopefully we can improve this process and also potentially do this as we continue to put other properties on the market for the city.
So Bobby, before we take questions, can you just highlight how easy it is to do business in Norfolk for developers, builders, and contractors who submit an application that is completed? It doesn't take a year to get a building permit. I was at a Civic League last night, and it was reported, although unsubstantiated, that it takes a year to get a building permit in the city of Norfolk. I dispel that. It was no data. They didn't source it. But can you just, as the administrator of that area, can you just highlight how easy it is for a developer, contractor, builder with a completed application, not submitting an application that's incomplete?
Yes, sir.
Can you just speak to that? And it doesn't take a year.
Yes, sir, I can. All of the processes that are managed by the Department of City Planning, as long as the application is complete and the information is complete, that we're able to assist the citizens, whether it be a building permit, the site plan review process, or even the conditional use permit process, it moves fairly quickly through the process. We will say that the current goal that my team has for building permit plan review is 10 working days, regardless of residential or commercial. For the site plan review process, it's 4 to 5 weeks for the first submittal, 2 to 4 weeks for the second submittal, again, depending on how efficiently the engineer is. And then also in the conditional use permit process, it is required to be, if they submit a complete application from the point of that submittal deadline, it's required by code to be heard by the Planning Commission within 45 days, which is hardwired in the zoning ordinance, which is not typical of other localities. So again, I thank you for your emphasis, Mr. Mayor, on completed application, as well as full information. Our team works very hard to try to help applicants get through the application process and provide all the information necessary.
Thank you.
I saw some hands go up. I saw the manager hand go up. So.
Thank you, Mayor. I just want to emphasize something I said a few months ago when we talked about the development of this idea. We've got properties from different parts of the city, but the bulk of these that we're showcasing in this first phase we're doing are centrally located in Ward 3. So Mrs. Johnson has been very gracious enough to provide some opening remarks and context on some successes we've had in this area of the city. And so we invite all council members to participate, and we thank Councilwoman Johnson for her participation and in helping us put this together.
All right, who's next? Thank you, Bobby.
All right. Bobby, is a planning update next?
Thank you. All right. Moving on to the next presentation, Mr. Mayor. The planning update. We have two items that are scheduled to be heard by the City Council that are of note. Although both of these items were voted on unanimously by the Planning Commission, they do include entertainment, and so I wanted to take the opportunity to at least brief the council on each of these items. First item is Birdies LLC for a conditional use permit to have live entertainment and extended hours of operation and the serving of alcoholic beverages at 2419 Hampton Boulevard. The use is an indoor recreation center, which is permitted by right. It's the addition of live entertainment, alcohol sales, and extended hours of operation, which require the conditional use permit. Here's the floor plan for the site. In red, I've highlighted where they plan on having their proposed entertainment of live bands, karaoke, and tribute, bingo, to be centralized. Their concept is to have individual bays for virtual, virtual sports, as far as golf and other types of sports that can be done in a virtual manner. And they do plan on having entertainment. Here's their hours of operation. They are 10 a.m. until 10 p.m. Monday through Thursday, 10 a.m. until midnight on Friday, as well as 8 a.m. until midnight on Saturday, until 10 p.m. on Sunday. Again, noting their entertainment is proposed to be live band, karaoke, and tribute bingo. And they have a capacity of 142 total. By 6-0 vote, Planning Commission does recommend approval of this. It is consistent with the uses within the rail yards at Amherst Point, and there is a 2-year expiration this proposed use because it is entertainment. The next item that I will be briefing the council on is Uno Pizzeria and Grill for a conditional use permit to allow an existing restaurant to add forms of live entertainment and reduce their operating hours at 5700 East Virginia Beach Boulevard. Here's the floor plan of the existing Uno Pizzeria. They do have an existing conditional use permit to have entertainment as well as serving alcoholic beverages. They are looking to expand their type of entertainment that they're providing. Currently, they're only providing for entertainment for live bands. In an effort to assure that their operations align appropriately with uses and they don't be viewed as a nightclub, the applicant did propose to reduce their hours from to 11 p.m. instead of going to midnight. They have the same capacity with a total of 274. And they are adding entertainment options of, in addition to the live band, DJ, karaoke, open mic night, comedian, and trivia. By 6-0 vote, the Planning Commission recommends approval. They are reducing their hours of operation. The restaurant has been in operation since 1994, and they do have support of Lake Taylor Civic. One additional item, I wanted to give the council an update on NFK 2050. Staff has been heavily engaged with the public, trying to get as much public feedback and information as possible as we go through our phase one and phase two portions of NFK 2050. To date, since this, I would say, last winter, the planning staff has attended over 100 meetings meeting people where they are, whether it be pop-up meetings or their civic league associations, as well as the meetings that we're hosting ourselves. And so it's been a very important part of our staff to assure that they are meeting out with the public and meeting them where they are to provide, to allow them to provide input. And we believe we've gotten a significant amount of input from the public as we come through with this, and the project team has proposed some key goals of the plan that the Planning Commission is currently reviewing, and those key goals are from the public input that come from the citizens as well as the subject matter experts in the city and our partners. Along with that information, there is a public plan workshop that's proposed that is going to happen on October 26th at Granby High School. Thank you, Councilman Smigel, from 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. This is an opportunity. What we did is we invited every person that signed up, as well as the public, but we sent out individual invitations to everyone that said they wanted to participate further in the plan information. And so we sent them individualized emails based on their sign-up. And then also we will be pushing out with communications for the larger public to sign up. Again, this will be a planned workshop where we have the opportunity to kind of drill down on a couple key goals that will provide input to the Planning Commission as they move forward with providing their proposed plan to the City Council for your review.
If you want to come to that afterwards, you can help us decorate for our homecoming dance. Same space.
Sounds like fun.
Yeah.
Is it a planning thing?
Yes.
Plan 2050 thing? Okay.
With that, Mr. Mayor, I'll take any questions.
Mr. Smigel, you can provide refreshments and food.
They are provided all of that, so I don't have to provide any of that.
Yeah. All right, questions for Mr. Tahan. Bobby, well done. Okay.
It's a Saturday.
Thank you, Mayor. Chief Carroll has the next presentation.
Chief, welcome, sir. I think this is Chief's first presentation in work session for the council.
Yes, sir. First time.
What's your entourage with you?
And he is a Granby graduate as well.
Yes, I am. I won't be there to help you there.
You could use, that's where you could use the ladder truck.
All right. Well, thank you guys. Thank you for having us here today. Mayor, Vice Mayor, Council Members, City Attorney, and Mr. Bull, and of course, City Manager. This has been something we've been working on a while since I've been in office, and it's good to see it's coming to fruition. Basically, what we have here is a what we call a fire department full-time paramedic program. And this is a need for the fire department basically because we have a lot of paramedics leaving our department, going to other cities. And the reason for that is sometimes better pay, sometimes for better work-life balance. Because these full-time paramedics basically don't work the schedule that we work as firefighter paramedics and firefighter EMTAs, 24-hour shifts. This new workforce, they have the mindset they want to work 10, 12 hours, they want to go home. They don't want to work 24 hours a day. So that's the advent of the full-time paramedic. In working with the city manager, he has kind of guided us and helped us reach this point of hiring 12 full-time medics. This will help us alleviate some of our overtime issues. It'll definitely help with the morale of our current firefighter paramedics who are working, riding the medics every day, getting burned out. So the influx of these full-time paramedics would be a great thing to help the morale and also give us better service to the citizens as well. The goal, of course, is, like I said, is to staff our medics using, and these medics, these 12 full-time medics would be used as, they'd be staffed using our current vacancies and using our existing funds. So we're not asking for any additional funds at this point for FY25. But as you see, our focus is to build the program for later. And try to build it in FY26 with enhancements, and we'll work with the city manager and see if we can even get more than 12.
Chief, can I ask a question right before you change that slide?
Okay.
So 12 in FY25 is the fiscal year that we're currently in.
Yes, sir.
And you're gonna use existing funds, existing resources. You don't have an ask of the council. However, what is the need in order to keep the safety that you know we want to maintain? We applaud you and your team at Norfolk Fire Rescue for the tremendous work that you're doing. 12 right now will certainly help, but is 12 is going to get us to continue to provide the excellence in service that you're currently providing?
Well, yeah, I was going to get there, but since you asked right now, I'll let you know that ideally our staffing level for paramedics is 126. We have three different shifts, A, B, and a C shift, and ideally we'd like to have 42 on each shift, which gives us, makes that 126. That way we got three medics, three paramedics at each station, and they can rotate their riding assignments.
Just to clarify, you need 36 additional FTEs to get there based on what you have now?
Yes.
That we're shooting, we're ideally we would do 36. We could do 12 this year, but I think 36 is the target number.
36 is our target goal, yes.
For FY26. But right now he has a need.
That's right. We could do 12 now.
12 now, based on existing revenue resources without additional appropriations, what I'm getting at. Okay. All right. But if we need to look at, you know, doing more, I want to make sure, as Mr. Smigo always said, tell us what you need. Yeah, because we want to make sure we get it right.
Yes, sir.
So please finish your presentation, and I may have more questions, okay?
Okay. No problem. Let's see. Again, our key objectives are to mitigate staffing gaps, utilize our existing budget, and gather data to support our FY26 requests. Again, fire rescue, we staff 14 ALS medic units in the city every day, 24/7. Each medic unit has a paramedic and an EMTA, which the paramedic is he or she is the lead provider with the highest authorization for medical care. So they have a lot of responsibility out here on the streets. Typically, like I say, they work 24-hour shifts. They work 12 hours on the medic, 12 hours on the fire apparatus. These new full-time medics we got coming in, they're just strictly medic riders, which will bring our fire medics off the medics, give them breaks. Why are we here? Basically because of a few trends that are going on. A lot of our regional friends, they've already got this program in place, and we've been a feeding ground. We've lost, since I've been in office, I know I've lost 10 AIC ALS providers. And just to make it sound better, though, we've been in touch with lots of them, and they knew we were trying to get this, and they said that once we get this, they would love to come back to Norfolk. People want to work in Norfolk, so that's a good thing to know. Again, historically, we've been at 126 paramedics in the city, in the department. Right now, our shortfall right now, we're at 93. So our daily paramedics, they're being taxed. A lot of overtime goes toward hiring back paramedics from the other shift to still work overtime, keep our numbers up. And one thing we've been doing is using our officers, our paramedic officers, to staff the medic units, which is not ideal because that's taking our leadership off the streets. And these guys are our supervisors, train our new people coming in, but they can't do all that when they're riding the medics because our medics are pretty busy here in the city of Norfolk. I mean, we've got one on Norview Avenue that's the busiest one in the state, and our medics run about 42,000, 43,000 calls a year.
Can I address that real quick?
Yes, sir.
Now, pre-COVID, I brought up the issues with the response to interstate accidents due to the 264 interchange. And there were some VDOT officials here about trying to bump up the correction there, because when you're heading south on 64 going towards 264. It's a very awkward merging over on a incline that causes quite a few accidents that either the Norview station or the Poplar Hall station are constantly responding to those accidents. And there's been no correction to that interchange or where that's happening. So the data will show that your responses are probably very high at those two stations too, because we're responding to something that could be corrected by VDOT that will allow them to have more openings to respond to things that are on our city streets as well. But years ago, Firefighter Union pointed that out to me, that there was a lot of unnecessary constant if they would fix that traffic issue there. Do y'all know what I'm talking about?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, because people try to merge over right on the incline and they all hit each other there. So anyway, sorry.
That's okay.
Yeah.
Good information. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And one of the things we're doing, paramedic training. We try to train paramedics in-house. We send people to Tidewater Community College. And that costs us money because they get tuition reimbursement, but we absorb the overtime because we let them go on duty days just to help us get where we need to be. So again, that's another reason we need these full-time medics to help with that overtime issue. Again, our pilot program, our 12 medics, full-time medics right now under our existing budget. And the anticipated benefits, it will provide the city of Norfolk with employment opportunities for highly trained providers in a competitive market, because Norfolk is the place that paramedics want to work in. You know, Norfolk is the city around here. Norfolk is, you get all types, you get a diversity of calls here. It also gives us positions, we have potential to impact staffing challenges that we have and the overtime. Another benefit is that it provides timely addition of paramedics to support our departmental morale, which is like is going down, and it's my job to help keep the morale up. So I really appreciate your support in this pilot program.
Can I throw on an additional
request,
Mr. Manager, since we're doing a pilot program? Can we also add in a bonus if you are bilingual in Spanish?
Do you have that for police? I know of. Do
we
have it
for all employees?
We do have
that they have to go through a certification process. It's $3,000 a year.
So I'm for this.
They would be eligible.
But I'm saying more than $3,000 because there's a separate life and death situation with responding when there's communication issues and you don't have somebody who can communicate quickly with a family member who needs to explain what's going on. And opening up an app and trying to get a translation is not fast. I can barely do it when I'm in school. So I'm just suggesting that to look into emergency response and concentrating your bilingual speakers in communities like Station 13, and Ocean View has a high Hispanic, Norview area has high Hispanic, Fisherman's Road, not Fisherman's, sorry, Little Creek, because that's where our growing Hispanic populations are in the city. And it would make a huge difference just talking to my Hispanic students. We're already seeing a little bit of a difference with police, which has been great, you know, with that, but with EMT, it would make a huge difference in that recruitment, yeah.
And just to let you know, we're also testing some dedicated handheld translation devices in six departments to see if that will help.
They do have those, yes.
Yeah,
they're expensive. The good ones are very expensive.
Yeah, we know, but we're
trying. Yeah.
Chief Carroll, we continue.
All right, sir. And again, this plan will reduce the necessity of our fire officers to ride the medic units, and that's pretty huge for us to keep our leadership in the stations where they need to be training our men and women to be better firefighters. Future plans and enhancements, again, for the FY26 enhancement request, we'll be looking at developing a career path for these full-time paramedics, because like any job, anyone will know whether you got a, you know, chance for advancement. So that's what we're gonna look at building next FY26 budget, and establishing our EMS supervisory framework, budget enhancements, our compensation strategies, you know, we're gonna look out for our current firefighter paramedics. In FY26, we're gonna look at trying to develop a stipend for them, because basically they're doing two jobs, and our full-time medics will be doing one. Our firefighter medics will be doing two jobs, and we need to find something to compensate them with. So that's in our FY26 budget. And educational opportunities, and again, we're always looking for ways to find people, find ways for our people to train up. We do have that right now. We're looking at developing an in-house paramedic school at our training center on Gold Street. We got relationships with Tidewater. That's when most of our people go. They go out there and they got an accelerated program, which kind of takes about 5 or 6 months. But that's just the schooling part. But then once they get finished with the schooling, is, you know, they got to do certain other things before they actually get cut loose as a paramedic. Might be another 3 or 4 months before they actually get cut loose. So, you know, if we send someone to school, the return on that might not be for at least sometimes up to 2 years, basically. So again, full-time medics coming in, they're ready to ride within a couple of weeks of getting an orientation and the checkoff from our medical director. Again, this is the staffing plan, the salary we're looking at paying these people. It's the same starting salaries as our current firefighter medics, but they will have a built-in overtime to give them a little more. They're also eligible for more overtime if they like. They'll be sworn employees, just like our firefighter medics are. And their work schedule will be a three days on, 3 days off, 3 days on, 3 days off. And that's how they are basically work. So they got 12-hour shifts. They got opportunities, again, for overtime if they want that. It just won't be 24 hours consecutively on the medic. Next steps is to... Hopefully you all understand what we're saying here and agree with what the need is to get more paramedics on the street, keep our service to the citizens going. I request that you consider our proposal and support our initiative.
Thank you, Chief.
Any questions?
All right. Questions for Chief Carroll.
Thank you.
Yeah. I'm just sitting here thinking, I'm looking at Tommy and thinking about our school system. Are there opportunities to do something from a vocational standpoint while kids are still in high school that set them up for certification?
Not for EMT. They have the firefighter program already at NTC, but I don't think it includes anything with EMT.
Is that possible to include that, to add that?
What's your hiring age?
18.
18, yeah. Then yes.
I'm just wondering if there's maybe an opportunity to coordinate with Norfolk Public Schools, dual enrollment, TCC,
yeah.
Something along those lines.
That's an avenue we can look at.
That means we'd have to do more dual enrollment with
Norfolk Public Schools.
That's another discussion.
All right. Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
All right, Mr. Roberts.
We have several items for closed session considerations.
Okay. Mr. Bull.
I move that members of the council assemble informally and close meeting on October 8, 2024 at 4:15 p.m. in the 10th floor conference room of the City Hall building of the City of Norfolk for the purposes which are set out in clauses 3, 3, 29, 7, and 7 of subsection A of section 2.2-37 11 of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act as amended. Clause 3, discussion the disposition of real property in Ward 2, Park Place area, where discussion in an open meeting would adversely affect the negotiating strategy of the public body. Clause 3, discussion of the disposition of real property in Ward 4, Virginia Beach Boulevard area, where discussion in an open meeting would adversely affect the negotiating strategy of the public body. Clause 29, discussion of the award of a public contract on property in Ward 2, Large Barn area, where discussion in an open session would adversely affect the negotiating strategy of the public body. Clause 7, consultation with legal counsel on a housing matter where such consultation in an open matter would adversely affect the negotiating posture of the public body. Clause 7, consultation with legal counsel on a legal briefing where such briefing in an open meeting would adversely affect the negotiating posture of the public body. Ms. Doyle.
Aye.
Ms. Johnson.
Aye.
Ms. McClellan.
Aye.
Mr. Page.
Aye.
Ms. Royster.
Aye.
Mr. Smeagol.
Aye.
Mr. Thomas.
Aye.
Dr. Adams.
Aye.
We're in closed.